Welcome to the church in Regent Park, everyone. We miss you all. We love you all. We hope you enjoy the service tonight. Thank you so much.
We miss you. We'll see you soon.
Thank you. Gonna let me down. You're You're my refuge in the storm. Through these trials, you've always been faithful. You bring healing to my soul. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go.
Each and every Saturday to pray for your needs, and we do have some needs that have come in over the last couple of days, and so we want to continue to pray for Sonia's niece, who lives in the Washington DC area. She is a frontline worker, and she's come down with COVID-19, so we want to continue to pray that she would make a full recovery. We prayed for Willie and Wayne's granddaughter Maddie, who has had an improvement in her sight, which we're so excited about, but she took an unfortunate fall this week, and so we want to pray for her and her arm. We want to pray that God would continue to bring an end to this virus in Canada, around the world, that we would see protection of our volunteers as they come faithfully and courageously on Saturday nights and help us serve a meal to 300 people. And we also want to pray a blessing over our mothers and grandmothers and those other women in our church who may not have kids of their own but are making a difference and discipling others. We want to pray a blessing upon them as well. And so I've invited my friend Paige, who's one of our junior high students, to join us in prayer. And if you do have a need and you want us to pray with you, then you can email us at prayer@cirptoronto.ca. Or you can call us and leave us a message at 416-756-9509. Thank you for being willing to pray for us tonight, Paige. And why don't we pray right now?
Okay. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we pray for Sonia, her niece, Jarell, that is sick with COVID-19. We hope that you will touch her with your great power, and that you will cure her. And we also pray for Will and Wayne, a girl named Maddie, that hurt her arm, and we would like her to get more better, and her arm will be good and cure. And we also want to pray for the volunteers that have been working at Regent Park, and how we're very thankful and that they're helping us during this bad virus. And we also want scientists and doctors to find a cure for this COVID-19 and the virus, so then this will all end and then we can continue our lives. And we would also like to pray for grandmothers and mothers, since it is Mother's Day this Sunday. And in your name, Heavenly Father, amen.
Amen. All right, great. We thank you, Paige, for being willing to do that. And we hope you'll continue to stay tuned as Pastor Kim brings an amazing message tonight.
Whew. Jeez. Well, I've been known to do a thing or two around the kitchen. I sure know what it's like to cook for 6 people, but I couldn't imagine what it's like to cook for 350. So I'd like to take this time to thank all the volunteers last week that helped prepare the meals for 350 people in Regent Park. And also, I'd like to encourage you this Wednesday to tune in for our Zoom group at 7 o'clock. Join us if you haven't yet. It's a good time. I've learned a lot.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers, grandmothers, and leaders in our church who invest in the lives of others. We're so thankful for you and we appreciate you. I wanted to show my appreciation for Pastor Kim and give her a day out that she could get her hair done. Well, that's not going to happen. Or maybe she could go shopping. No, she can't do that either. Well, maybe she could walk to McDonald's or something like that. Anyways, she's left me here with the kids, and needless to say, things haven't gone as planned.
arms, I hope that this weekend you feel appreciated and loved. And I hope that you have some time for yourself and that you're able to relax. I don't know about you, but with all this extra time on our hands over the last couple of weeks, a number of people have been picking up new hobbies. I know a number of my friends on Facebook have been posting photos of what they're doing to occupy their time. It's interesting that some people would make quilts, some people would do TikTok videos, some people have picked up baking. I know my family has definitely benefited from my daughter and her baking skills. Some people have started home renovations. Some people have been writing songs, and the list goes on and on of things that people have been doing to occupy their time. I don't know about you, but if you ever done a jigsaw puzzle, not just any little jigsaw puzzle, but one of those gigantic, at least 1,000 pieces or more. My grandpa, when he was alive, was fascinated with putting these jigsaw puzzles together. And very often when we would go to see him, his dining room table would be completely filled with all of these pieces. He absolutely loved it. In their living room, they had a floor to ceiling length, as big as the wall, a puzzle of a beautiful ship. And I just remember thinking how many hours that would take, how much patience it would take to put together that beautiful puzzle. Anytime there was an occasion, we couldn't go wrong by giving a puzzle because he loved to do that. You know, it's interesting when you look at a box of puzzle pieces, it doesn't look like much. But then when they all are taken out and put together, what a beautiful picture there is. It's interesting that if you're missing one piece of the puzzle, it's incomplete. I can imagine the frustration of someone putting together a beautiful puzzle to come and find that there's a piece missing. And then the search goes on for the missing piece. You know, one puzzle piece on its own doesn't look like much. But as I said, when you put it all together, it's a beautiful picture. Puzzles are like life sometimes, except for one major difference. You get to see the result, the end result of what the puzzle will look like before you even get started. You see, there's a picture on top of the box, so there's no surprise. You know exactly what it will look like. We already know how it's going to turn out. We already know the ending. It's interesting that our lives are like puzzles as well, and that God has put together a unique plan and a unique purpose for each and every one of us. God himself is the only one who knows what that puzzle will look like. And I don't know about you, but if you're going through a tough time today, sometimes it's hard to get stuck on that one piece of puzzle, thinking, where does this fit? I can assure you today that God has a plan and a purpose for your life. And even though it may not make sense right now, it's not a mess to God. And he has something beautiful to make out of your life. I know there's times that it may seem uncomfortable. We may go through some unwelcome storms. But just as one tiny piece of puzzle is missing, things would not be complete. We need all the pieces of the puzzle, the good, the bad, the easy, the difficult, to shape and to guide us on the unique individual path that God has set before us. I guarantee that those difficult times are never wasted, that God uses all of those. We learn in times of uncertainty how faithful and true God is, that our faith can be strengthened, that he is in control, and when we give him control over everything in our lives, how he walks with us completely, guiding us from the beginning to the end and every single step in between. We only see the one piece, maybe, that we're stuck on right now, but he sees exactly where that piece belongs. John Piper said, "Life is not a straight line leading from one blessing to the next and then finally to heaven. Life is a winding and troubling road, switchback after switchback, and the point of biblical stories like Joseph and Job and Esther and Ruth help us to feel in our bones, not just in our head, that God is with us even in all these strange terms. God is not just showing up after the trouble and trying to clean things up. He is plotting the course and managing the troubles with far-reaching purpose for our good and for the glory of Jesus Christ. God valued relationship with us above creating a world that was perfect without relationship. But because of Adam and Eve's choice, evil, disobedience, and pain entered our world. In the moments that we have together tonight, we're going to look at how God's help is there for us. He helps us when we experience pain. He's there with us in suffering, even in death. And it doesn't matter how the circumstance may look, God does not abandon his children. In fact, he reminds us that he protects us over every area of our lives. Tonight, if you want to join with me in reading the scripture, if you have your smartphone, or you're welcome to read along with me in your Bible, we're going to take a look at Psalms 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. This scripture may have been a song that was sung on the way to Jerusalem, which was located on the side of Mount Zion. These people may have looked with anxiety if they expected robbers to be waiting in the hills for them. The hills provided cover for the robbers. And as travelers contemplated making that journey through the hills to Jerusalem, this song reminds them of the assurance of the Lord, the keeper of Israel, that he would keep them on the journey at all times. Are you thankful for that today? I don't know about you, but sometimes it's hard as a mom to ask for help. Maybe you find it very easy, but I'm thankful that God hears our cries for help. You know, as a mom, sometimes we celebrate even the smallest victories. You know, it could be 9 a.m. and we celebrate that our children haven't gotten a fight yet. We're doing pretty good. Maybe you've prayed this prayer before. Dear Lord, so far I've done all right. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I haven't been greedy or grumpy or nasty or selfish or overindulgent. And I'm really glad about that. But God, in a few minutes, I'm going to get out of bed. And from then on, I'm going to need your help a whole lot more. Where does our help come from? We just read in those scriptures in verse 1 and 2, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. You see, the travelers were heading to worship God in the temple, and they are reminding themselves that help does come from the Lord. God, who created all that is in heaven and earth, even in us, is the one who provides help. Whether the road is easy, whether the road is tough, God is there. You know, it's interesting that the enemy wants to keep us from the real, authentic love and help that comes from the maker of heaven and earth. Our help comes from the Lord. And I'm thankful that we do not need to do things alone, that God is with us. So today, don't believe those lies of Satan. God is for you. God is with you, and God will carry you. You know, we believe in a God who is all-powerful and all-knowing, and the promise that God will not abandon us at the first sight of trouble. Are you thankful for that today? Perhaps you need help. Maybe you have circumstances that are just very heavy for you. Maybe with relationships. Maybe you have pain in your body. Maybe there's stress over your children or your finances. Take encouragement today from the one who offers real help to the problems that you're facing. So how does he help? First of all, he protects us from ourselves. He will not let your foot slip. You see, these folks have been walking, and maybe the roads were rocky and rough. and maybe that was on their mind. I don't know about you, but I am not the best person at keeping my balance. I love to wear heels, and I don't seem to have a problem when I'm in heels, but the moment I'm in flats, I don't know why, but I often will fall. My kids sometimes call me Bambi. A couple of years ago, I was working at a senior's home, and I was helping to give tours of the apartments to a beautiful couple. And they had wanted to make an appointment to come back and to check out the apartment that they were going to rent. And so I arranged for them to come back. That day was extra busy for me, and I remember leaving my desk and grabbing my clipboard, and just in a rush to go and meet them, I grabbed the clipboard and I went as quickly as I could. You know, I was not watching where I was going, but I remember getting into the building and seeing this beautiful couple just standing at the elevator waiting for me. And I wasn't watching where I was going. I just was looking at my clipboard, and would you believe it, I fell into a little divot in the ground. I don't even know, it was like so little, and it caused me to fall flat on my face in front of this lovely couple and in front of a whole team of construction workers. You see, there was construction happening in the building, and they had signs up about being careful and watch your step. But I was in such a rush that I fell flat on my face. It was so embarrassing. I'm thankful for all of those people that came to help me and to get up. And here I've cut my leg and I've got blood on my leg, and this sweet couple is just wanting to help me. You know, I do an incident report and all that's entailed with that. And I thought, I didn't take time. I didn't look up. I just looked at my clipboard. Have you ever watched folks that are tightrope walkers? I mean, I don't know that I would ever be able to do what they do. Going to Canada's Wonderland on rides kind of scare me. And even the CN Tower, the heights are just too much for me. I do it, but I don't enjoy it. But you know, when you look at a tightrope walker, there's so much skill. There's so much how they are up on this wire and they keep their balance. Dan Thurman, in his book, Off Balance on Purpose, says this. These daredevils are constantly making small critical adjustments, lifting their free leg as a counterweight, raising and lowering their arms, adjusting their pole. A good tightrope walker is never truly off balance or at rest. As a matter of fact, they are perpetually off balance, making adjustments that bring them through a point of balance, only to readjust on the other side. Most of these movements are so subtle that they're unnoticed by most of the audience. They make it look effortlessly, but it's not as easy as they look. So how do they manage to keep their balance? He continues to say that new students that step onto that rope or cable often do the very same thing, but their game is flawed right from the beginning. They stare down at the wire. They look at the wire to make sure they have proper footing, but they fall. So what's the solution to the dilemma? Have you ever watched the professional tightrope walkers? If you recall, they don't look down. They keep their head up. They don't look to the side, to the left or the right. They keep their head up. They look straight ahead at the faraway platform, and they walk towards that goal. You know, when we follow God's direction, He will keep us from stumbling and falling. He will not let your foot slip. And we can be certain that we will not fall because His eyes are on us. Regardless the happenings in your life, whether at home or at work, the Lord is there to help and protect you. Are you thankful that God does not need sleep? That He is constantly caring for you, that He is constantly keeping watch. In this scripture that we just read, 6 times it mentions that He's keeping watch over you, that He's guarding us. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. You know, today, whether you are watching this in your home, whether you're in your car, whether you're in your doctor's office, sitting on the bus, no matter where you are, God has a plan for you. a plan for you to help you get through the diagnosis, the busyness, the project that you have, the responsibilities, whatever you have, he's already gone before, and he's prepared the way. Secondly, God protects us from other dangers. It's not very often that we look to escape the sun here in Canada. I mean, with the climate that we're facing right now in May, it feels like we're in a polar vortex. But shade was a real need in Israel. In other words, God provides protection or defense. He never gives up in the middle of the night. He's always on guard. Verse 6 says, he protects us from the dangers of the night and the day, represented here by the sun and the moon. He protects them throughout the day as he is at their right hand. The Lord is your shade. A couple of years ago, our son had been quite insistent to be able to walk to school alone. At the time, as maybe because he was the youngest, I thought, you know, this little eager boy who's very independent and a busy street do not mix. But I wanted him to feel that he was able to walk to school. And oftentimes he went with his sister. However, I thought, you know, I'm going to make a plan to walk with him for a certain point, and then he can go on his own. So we would get up and get ready for school, and then I would walk him to where the crossing guard was. And he would say goodbye and then walk the rest of the way to school. You know, he didn't know that I was watching from the moment he left until he actually got to school. And sometimes, as a sneaky mom might do, I would follow far enough behind that he didn't see me, but that I knew he was okay. Maybe you can relate. Do you follow at a distance sometimes, far enough that your child doesn't see you? I love the verse in Psalms 139, verse 5. It reminds me that you go before me and you follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Our Heavenly Father walks with us. God knows exactly where we're going, and he's there to protect us, even when we can't see him. Just as I protected my son who was walking to school, he didn't know that I was watching the whole way until he got there. You know, that truth is especially encouraging as we continue to see our children, or maybe your grandchildren, continue to grow. We can't always be in the schoolyard or near the crossing guard of life to watch that they get to where they need to go. But we can trust that our Heavenly Father does. Whether they're facing a tough exam, whether they're driving on their own for the very first time, or even if they're dealing with a bully, God is with them, and we can trust that he is with them. Verse 7 and 8 says, the Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. He keeps, he guards from all harm. How encouraging is that tonight? Writer Robert Fisher notes this. There's a difference between having and keeping. For instance, I might have a favorite sweater. It's in my possession. However, I keep my puppy. He's not merely a possession, but a beloved dog. He's very dear to me. Therefore, I watch him not for my sake, but for his. I protect him from harm because if he suffers, it hurts me too. Likewise, God does not merely have us, God keeps us. We are God's beloved and immeasurably dear to God. We are not merely possessions in his eyes, because if we suffer, it hurts God too. Can you celebrate today and say thank you that God is our keeper? Thirdly, God protects us at all times. The Lord watches over your comings and your goings, and that refers to the daily activities of your life, what's on your calendar, those things that you don't think even matter. All those tasks, the daily tasks, our schedules, our planner that's always filled, These minor details that we often take for granted, God is aware of. Now and forevermore refers to the present and in the future. No matter what you're going through, something significant or insignificant, God sees, and he will continue to be with you. You know, in our series that we've just finished walking through, why does people experience hurt? It reminds me that many people struggle to understand why painful things happen. They wonder why the Lord wouldn't stop from such heartache. But if we were to think of it, we rarely give thought to all of the time that God has kept us from harm. Many people interpret that verse to mean that God will keep them from difficulty. But the Lord does allow pain in our lives. God understands hurt. He also looks for a deeper meaning in the situation that we're facing. Trials often strengthen our faith to make us more like Jesus and to have compassion for others. At times, God will use difficult situations to keep us from becoming satisfied in our spiritual walk. When our Heavenly Father knows what's best, he doesn't necessarily keep us from pain. Instead, he enables us to endure it in the hardships by giving us that wisdom and strength. And when we get to the other side, we can often see with profound thankfulness how his loving and gracious hand guided us through the whole situation. You see, God sees that big picture, and problems are part of life. Today, I encourage you, don't let the problems that you're facing distance you from God's invitation to come close. Maybe right now you're struggling with the fact that God doesn't give you something or someone that you've been praying about. You know, it is really hard in the moment to see what God is doing in that particular situation. But I know that in my experience that I can trust God with even the difficult days. And often I realize that God has been saving me from certain situations. Today, have confidence that God is concerned about the details. He loves you. He loves you. So today I would ask you, would you say yes to God, asking for his help? I know sometimes it's difficult for us to ask for help, but God is so close, and he is there to guide and to direct and to give you strength. No matter what you're facing today, God can use it for good. You may not see it now, but God will use it for good. God's plan is always best. You know, we moved a couple of years ago, and our kids were so sad to know that they were going to be moving from their friends. They didn't understand. We knew that it was best, even though we didn't give them all the details. And so that's what it's like with God. There's so much that God protects and keeps us from. So we shouldn't be discouraged when we experience hardships. He is there. Don't doubt what God can do through you and through the situation that you're in right now. In closing tonight, I am thankful that God's help is constantly available for each and every one of us. Every one of you in your living rooms right now. For all the moms, the grandmas, everyone that's tuned in tonight, God wants to give that help, that it's constantly available. And I'm especially thankful that he's available in my day-to-day juggling as a woman, as a wife, as a mom, as a working mom, and even as someone who wants to point others to Christ. I'm thankful that his strength is available to help us, and especially available to give us joy. Friends, maybe today you're having a great day. Maybe you're having a day where you are lacking courage. Maybe you're having a messy house kind of day. Maybe you're having a I can't do it another kind of day. Whatever it is, God is with you and will meet you where you are. And when we put our trust and hope in him and we focus, it's amazing what he will do through your life. He wants to give you that hope, that joy, that peace, that love, and that strength that you need. Perhaps you would say today, you know, I want to have that strength that you're talking about. I would love to experience that. The Bible says that God loves you so very much that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for you, to stand in the gap for your sins. It also says that it doesn't matter what our past has been like or the bad decisions that we've made, we can be forgiven and we can have a fresh start. And so maybe you've never prayed that prayer tonight, or you've never had that relationship with Jesus. Perhaps once you did, and now you're away from him. I want to encourage you tonight to pray this prayer with me if you've never done that before. Dear Jesus, right now, I want to make the decision to stop living my life my own way, and I want to begin living it your way. I ask that you would forgive me for my sins, give me a brand new start with a hope and a future. In your name, amen. You know, if you've prayed that prayer tonight, your life is forever changed. And we want to congratulate you on that. And we'd love to hear from you if you have made that prayer, that decision tonight. It's the best decision that you can make. God loves you so, so very much. Before we conclude our service tonight and we sing a song together, that we are not alone, that God is with us, I'd love the opportunity to pray with you, to pray for the moms that have joined us today. You know, Mother's Day can be a lot of emotions for many women. Maybe you're a first-time mom anticipating the birth of your child. Maybe you're a stepmom and trying to figure out where you fit in. Maybe there are folks that have lost their moms and are facing grief on this Mother's Day. And maybe there's the moms who are encountering hurt because their children turned from God. And maybe there are moms that are overwhelmed with pain from the loss of a child. No matter what you face this Mother's Day, you can turn to God and experience peace and healing that's available through prayer. It would be my privilege to pray for you tonight. Moms, you're doing a great job. I know it can be hard, but God is there to give us that strength that we need. And it is not difficult to ask him for help. It is not. And so even tonight, I pray that you will practice that, that you would say, God, I need you more than anything. Lord, I need you to come and to fill my life and to give me that fresh energy, that grace, that love, that peace, and all those wonderful things that you add to my life. I promise you, you won't be disappointed when you do that. Let's pray together. God, we just thank you that you give strength to each mom. Lord, we ask you to be their strength, their spiritual strength, their physical strength today, that you would be the source that is constantly in the forefront of their mind. God, would you draw each mom close to yourself today and renew her joy. God, would you open her eyes to daily blessings? God, would you give her such a steadfast heart that she might continue to look to you for your love and your guidance? God, would you show her the truest joy that comes from your presence and give her the grace that she needs today? God, today we also think of those who grieve. Lord, I ask for your comfort to surround those who weep. We pray for the peace of your presence to cover our minds and thoughts as you remind us the enemy can never steal us out of your hands. God, thank you that we are safe in your presence. When we need help, God, that we can always look to you, that you are always available, that you don't need that rest. God, that you are always available for us. God, we thank you that your ways are higher than our ways and your thoughts are bigger than our thoughts. And so, Lord, tonight we lay it at your feet, every burden, every care, believing that in your hands is the safest place to be. Lord, we love you. Would you fill us with fresh grace today? In your powerful name, amen. God bless you. Tonight, why don't you just join us as we sing this last chorus together, I Am Not Alone.
whatever we're going through, whatever situation, Lord, we know that you have everything in your hand and that we are not alone, Lord. So we just thank you for these truths tonight, Father. We thank you that you're with us, that you're guiding us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can lean in on you and press into you, Father, and know that you are there. Lord, as we go tonight, I just pray that you would just bless every person watching this, Father, that you would just be with us all, God, and bless this week, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us tonight.